Welcome back to my stand-up channel. It's the greatest military defeat of all time. Trump rages at Biden over chaotic Afghanistan exit at rally and calls it a total surrender. That would never have happened if I was president. Donald Trump blasted Joe Biden on Saturday over the disastrous withdrawal from Afghanistan and accused him of giving the U.S. military away to the Taliban as he appeared at a rally for thousands of supporters in Cullman, Alabama. This will go down as one of the greatest military defeats of all time, Trump said. Trump called the situation in Afghanistan a humiliation, claiming it's not a withdrawal but rather, a total surrender. The former president told the massive crowd gathered in the deep red state that, this would have never happened if I was president. He said, the issue here is not whether to leave Afghanistan. The issue is Joe Biden's staggering incompetence and gross negligence, creating the greatest strategic humiliation that we've ever seen as a country. With me in office, the Taliban would not have ever dreamt of capturing our airfield or parading around with our American weapons. There would have been no emergency embassy evacuation and no taking down of our flag. Because we would have established clear lines that the Taliban would never have dared to cross. The problem with Biden is that our enemies are not afraid of him, they don't respect him. It came as pictures emerged of Taliban fighters bearing a combination of U.S. military hardware and that used by Afghan forces, likely seized as Western and Allied forces withdrew from the country. Our military is being given to the enemy, he said. Trump also defended his original negotiations with Taliban leaders, after he was criticized for meeting with the warlord leaders while in office. Who the hell else am I supposed to be negotiating with? He asked. Trump made a conditional peace deal with the Taliban in 2020 to reduce the number of Afghan troops if the Taliban did not provide support to terrorists. Trump agreed to a full military withdrawal by May 1st of this year. The Biden administration has blamed Trump for the timeline leading to the botched withdrawal. Biden extended the deadline to September 11th and then pledged to have all U.S. troops out by August 31st. And Trump said he was tough in the negotiations and warned the Taliban. If anything happens, we will rain terror upon you. Don't touch our American citizens, Trump said he told the Taliban leader. Don't touch our American citizens. He also owned his decision to set a deadline for withdrawing all U.S. troops from Afghanistan, claiming after 20 years it was time to leave the region and let them fight out their civil war without Americans' lives lost in the process. In just over a week, the Taliban was able to take over almost all of Afghanistan, including the capital city of Kabul. President Joe Biden's handling of the withdrawal was slammed by all sides. Trump only ended his speech after it started to drizzle at the farm against after hours of clear skies between attendees' entry and the speech. After nearly an hour and a half of speaking, the president noticed people were beginning to leave because of the rain. By the way, it's starting to rain, Trump said. I will prove to you it's my hair. The comment was met with roaring laughter from the thousands-strong audience. The pregame show before Trump took stage included a short speech by Alabama Senator Tommy Tuberville. He lauded the crowd size, claiming there were people as far as he could see onto the field at York Family Farms. They used to call it Woodstock. This is Trump stock here in Cullman County, he said to massive cheers. Chairman of the Alabama Republicans, John Wall, used his remarks to call critical race theory a demonic doctrine from the pit of hell. Trump also said that Wall was able to bring in $1.2 million in fundraising for the party by putting on the event. Trump arrived to a muggy mid-80s weather, which settled after a bout of rain struck the farm grounds hours before his arrival. Hundreds of supporters waited out a 45-minute thunderstorm after gaining entry to the rally venue. Thousands more continued to wait in line outside the farm grounds in the rain. Many donned red, Keep America Great, plastic ponchos. Trump traveled to the deep red state on Saturday for the first time since his rally on February 28, 2016 in Madison, Alabama, as he looks to help Representative Mo Brooks in running for the Senate. To the right of the stage was a whole tent dedicated to Brooks's Senate campaign. Alabama Senator Richard Shelby is retiring at the end of his sixth term, and so far, four Republicans are vying in the 2022 midterms primaries to replace him: Brooks, Linda Blanchard, Katie Britt, and Jessica Taylor. Trump slammed Shelby last month for endorsing Britt, who previously served as the senator's chief of staff. "She's like family. She'd make a good candidate. She's probably the best qualified candidate to come along in a long time," Shelby said of Britt, according to a June report. "I'd support her. I'd vote for her." Trump used that opportunity to lash out against Shelby, Britt, and Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell. "I see that the Rhino senator from Alabama, close friend of old crow Mitch McConnell, Richard Shelby, is pushing hard to have his assistant fight the great Mo Brooks for his Senate seat," he wrote in a statement at the time. "She is not in any way qualified and is certainly not what our country needs or not what Alabama wants," he continued. "For Mitch McConnell to be wasting money on her campaign is absolutely outrageous." He also issued his endorsement for Brooks during that July 10th statement. "Vote for Mo Brooks. He stands for America First and everything Alabama wants. He also has my complete and total endorsement." Representative Marjorie Taylor Greene was walking around the rally campaigning for Brooks and speaking to some of Trump's most fervent supporters. She held a Brooks's campaign sign for much of the night but switched to an "Impeach Biden" sign at some point as she joined Trump as calling for Biden's removal over his handling of Afghanistan. Brooks made some remarks just before Trump took stage, but lost the audience when he told them to try and forget about 2020 and move forward to winning 2022 and 2024. In a video that played before Brooks took stage, it showed a clip of him at the January 6th rally in front of the White House where he told people they would start taking down names and kicking ass. That "Stop the Steal" rally in January led up to the Capitol riot, which got Trump impeached by the House for incitement of insurrection. He was acquitted by the Senate. People who lined up hours before the former president's arrival on Saturday ran to try and grab the limited seats available at York Family Farms as the audience started pouring into the venue around 2:15 p.m., nearly 5 hours before Trump's expected start time. Outside of a few hundred seats, there was room for thousands more to stand. As attendees made it through Secret Service checks, they were greeted with live music, a food vendor, and a free water station handing out Blue Spring Living Water, which comes from Blount, Alabama. There were also food vendors available outside the security perimeter for Trump supporters to snack on as they waited in line. Social media site Getter, which was created by former Trump aide and spokesman Jason Miller, was prominently promoted at the rally. A plane flew around York Daily Farms with a banner behind it reading, "Twitter sucks. Join Getter." The social media platform officially launched on July 4, 2021 as an obvious conservative alternative to Twitter, as the interface and gestures have been described as similar to Jack Dorsey's site. Many MAGA followers started seeking social media sites that wouldn't stifle or censor their posts and shares. Parler emerged as the clear alternative as a site that wouldn't censor posts and accounts, but that quickly turned sour when Apple took the app off its App Store. Getter emerged months later as an anti-censorship social media platform. While initial estimates of the crowd were not immediately known, organizers publicly said they expected about 20,000 people to attend the rally. Privately, they say 50,000 people applied for tickets, which could make it the biggest Trump rally in history. But having been burned last year, when they claimed a million people had RSVP'd for a rally in Tulsa, Oklahoma, only for 6,200 to attend, they were reluctant to make such predictions public. Crowds of tens of thousands present their own problems. Trump arrived in Cologne 2 days after it announced a public health emergency amid spiraling numbers of COVID-19 cases. A very minimal amount of rallygoers were seen donning face masks at the outdoor event. Most were naked-faced, while some more elderly attendees were seen with a mask. Whenever the topic of masks or vaccinations were brought up by a speaker, including Trump, the crowd issues their most pronounced boos and jeers. Alabama is one of the states experiencing the worst surge as the Delta variant ravages the nation and breakthrough cases in vaccinated Americans continue to spike. The case rates in Alabama are at the same level as they were in January. In a state with a 4.903 million population, the average number of cases per day sits at more than 4,500. A top ally previewed to DailyMail.com ahead of the speech that Trump would issue his strongest signal he's running in 2024 by calling for real leadership in the White House. "It's time for real leadership in the White House," the ally said the former president would say. Trump has joined Democrats and Republicans in spending the past week attacking President Joe Biden for his handling of the U.S. withdrawal from Afghanistan. "I'm expecting to hear the president use the line, 'It's time for real leadership in the White House,'" the source said. And even though aides say there is no final announcement, no final decision, it still is the clearest indicator that he's likely to run in 2024. The former president did not say whether he will run in the next presidential election, but he did say, "I was right about Biden. Not only have my predictions come 100% true, but it's even worse than any of us could have imagined in our worst nightmare," he said. "Joe Biden is a failed president," Trump explained. "He will always be a failed president. He ushered in one calamity after another. He listed those failures as the southern border crisis, rising crime rates in U.S. cities, the botched Afghanistan troop withdrawal, spiking gas prices, and his response to the pandemic, including vaccinations and crippling the ability of kids to return to in-person schooling." Trump said Biden has emboldened our enemies from China to Russia to North Korea to the Taliban. Trump has repeatedly hinted that he is planning a run, but insiders say no announcement is expected until after next year's midterms. He dangled the idea once again this week when Sean Hannity asked him the question live on Fox News. "So, because the campaign finance laws are extremely complicated and unbelievably stupid, I am actually not allowed to answer that question, can you believe that? I would love to answer it," he said. "But let me put it this way. I think you'll be happy, and I think a lot of our friends will be very happy." Biden's approval ratings have been in freefall. First after a surge in COVID-19 cases and then amid the fallout from television images of chaos in Kabul. A Rasmussen Reports poll this week reported that Trump would beat Biden by 6 points if an election do-over were held now. Trump insiders say Biden's bungled handling of the crisis has reminded voters that they miss the former president's America First message. Trump himself has seized on the crisis to issue a running commentary with emailed statements and television interviews. On the eve of the rally, he said, "Joe Biden must apologize to America for allowing the military to leave before civilians and for allowing $85 billion worth of sophisticated military equipment to be handed over to the Taliban and Russia and China so they can copy it, rather than bringing it back to the United States." And earlier in the week, he spelled out his concerns in detail to Hannity. "It's not the concept of leaving," he said. "It's the way they withdrew. It was not even possible to believe." Biden and his officials have claimed their hands were tied by a deal struck with the Taliban by Trump. But the former president said he made clear in negotiations there would be consequences if Mullah Abdul Ghani Baradar, the Taliban's political chief, failed to stick to the terms of their deal. "We had a very strong conversation," he said. "I told them up front, I said, 'Look, before we start, let me just tell you right now that if anything bad happens to Americans or anybody else, or if you ever come over to our land, We will hit you with a force that no country has ever been hit with before. A force so great that you won't even believe it, and your village. And we know where it is, and I named it, will be the first one. American officials say they have been in contact with Kabul's new rulers, the Taliban, who had promised safe passage for those trying to reach the airport. Trump said the U.S. had never suffered a worse humiliation, with thousands of potential hostages stuck in the country. You can go back to Jimmy Carter with the hostages. We all thought that was a great embarrassment and we were pulled out of that by Ronald Reagan, he said. This is a many, many times worse and you're dealing with thousands and thousands of Americans and others that are stranded and very dangerously really stranded in Afghanistan. Source. Dailymail.co.uk. Please like, share and subscribe. Thank you for watching.